Hey, what's going on, y'all? I'm Whiplash, and you're watching the FPV NoobTube. What's going on, guys? Today, I've got a huge list of... My dog is snoring. Okay, let's try that again. Had some issues last night, and I got some sleep. Had some coffee, had some breakfast, and we're ready to go again. So let's do this. I've got 2 tickets to paradise. No. I've got a huge list here. I've got like 4 pages, and then I had a bunch of other stuff too that I wanted to put in here. But I kind of tried to narrow it down to this, and it's still pretty large. So we're just gonna roll through as fast as we can. We're gonna put some stuff up here, show you some letters and words and what they mean. Just pretty much terms in the FPV hobby. Like RX, TX, VTX. Air conditioner kicked on that time, and I had to turn it off and wait for it to turn off. I don't know. First, we've got quad. What is a quad? It's a quad. What's quad mean? Quad means 4, and we got 4 motors or rotors, props, stuff like that. LOS. What is LOS? LOS is line of sight. So if you're looking at the quad and you're flying it and you're not looking through the goggles, you can see it and you're flying it around. It's pretty tough, but a lot of people start off that way anyways. That's line of sight. You can see, you have a line of sight with the quad. On the other hand, we have FPV. What is FPV? That's first person view. Pretty much it just means you're looking through the goggles and you can see what the camera can see through the quad. RX. TX, all these X's, what is that? RX is R for receive, T for transmit. The X just pretty much is just like, you're putting the X after all of these acronyms for like the fact that they're radio signals, maybe. So RX is receiver, which is gonna be like the little thing on here that receives the signal from your transmitter, which is gonna be your TX, this guy right here. So let's go over a couple more. What if we have a VTX? Well, we've got a video transmitter. So it's going to take like this. The camera's going to go plug into here. So your camera's given the signal. And then this is going to transmit with an antenna a signal. That being said, what is a VRX? Well, it's the same thing except it receives. So where's a VRX go? On the goggles. You got a video receiver on the goggles. So what we're going to talk about right now is y'all. What is y'all? Y-A-W. I say y'all all the time because I'm from the South. So how y'all doing? It's not the same. Y'all means that if it's flat, it's going to spin around like a thing that spins. I don't know. So it just spins, right? So what if you're pitched forwards? Well, it's still going to spin, but it's going to spin like this, okay? Round and round. All right, so what's pitch? P-I-T-C-H. Pitch. If this is the front, then when you pitch forwards, it's forwards. When you pitch reverse, it's reverse. Alright, so if you turn the forwards towards you, what's roll? Well, roll is like you're rolling down a hill. So you can roll left, and you can roll right. All that fun stuff. Real simple, just in case you didn't know the terms, or you got confused by them or something like that. Let's move on. Arm. That's a good one. Arm. Like this guy right here. No. So arming is the act of like starting or like initializing your quadcopter. And what you can do is you can use the throttle stick to the down and the right for a second and let go. Usually you like to hook it up to the computer, set an arming switch, and you're good to go. So if you're flying with a group of people and you kind of know how to work it, but then something happens and they freak out at you and they say, disarm, disarm. Well, disarm means unarm. So flip your switch or do your throttle stick. It takes a little bit of time to do that, so that's why we like to go to a switch. Prop. What's a prop? Well, prop is this guy, short for propeller, probably. I mean, it makes sense. So that's pretty much just these things. They come in all different shapes, sizes, colors. Don't get this word, but pitch. They come in different pitches. Don't get that confused with the other kind of pitch. It kind of means the same thing because if you look at it, it's like tilted up or down, depending. So kind of the same thing. This one's going to count a little bit towards the first one we said earlier. This is an axis. What is an axis? Well, this is going to be probably not totally right because I'm not a scientist, guys. I'm a firefighter and I like to fly quads. So what is an axis? Well, we have at least three axes. I don't know what plural for axis is. On a quadcopter. So we've got like the yaw, the roll, and the pitch axis. So pretty much that means like what is your where when you yaw. So if you were to yaw, like the center is going to be right here in the middle, and if you were to yaw, you're going to yaw around the middle like that. Well, if you pitch forwards, right, your yaw is going to go on this axis still. So this axis never changes compared to the quad. It may change compared to the ground. So when you pitch, but your axis stays here. So you have to yaw according to this imaginary line right here. We got CG. Okay, center of gravity. There's still a lot of confusion around this right now, mainly because it's kind of hard to measure accurately, at least with like instruments that we have around the house. So just know that your center of gravity is going to be, if you were to hang a string and it hangs kind of off a little bit, your center of gravity is off. You can move that battery around and you can try and get it centered up a little bit for you. All right, let's go over a few modes that we have here. So one, we've got acro. All right, so acro or rate mode means the same thing, and pretty much all that it means is that, and we're going to go over these terms as well in a minute, but you have the accelerometer and you have the gyro and stuff like that. It's thinking, you know, it's like it's thinking about what's going on, where it's at in space. Not in space, but just space. So, and while it's thinking, it's telling the motors and the ESCs what to do. So if you pitch forwards and you don't have any leveling, you're in acro, it's going to stay forwards forever. That's it. And then if you have to pitch backwards and then level it back out, and then it looks like this, and you're like, woo, woo, and then you crash it like I did the first time. So that being said, angle mode or level mode. Why is it called angle mode? Well, the best answer I think I could come up with is without Googling stuff, because I mean I Googled enough to just get this list, because angle mode will not let your quad pitch or roll past a certain angle. It's starting to make sense to me now. So I don't know what degree or whatever it would be, but pretty much that, you know. And then if you keep pressing the stick, it won't go even more. So it keeps it level, and then when you let go of the stick, it's right back level again. Real nice for line of sight, not so nice in the goggles. It's kind of hard to control like that. What else do we have? We have horizon mode. It's kind of like angle mode. It's kind of like acro mode. In horizon mode, you can it removes the angle restrictions. So if you want, you can flip. Okay, cool, fun stuff. But the flips aren't too smooth, because what happens is when you flip over, that accelerometer is thinking, and it's like, flip me over, flip me over, flip me back over now. And when you let go of the stick, it's going to go and flip right back over. Pretty neat if you want to show some friends some flips and stuff like that, or if you just want to have some fun. It's definitely a lot different than acro, and it's not one of those things where you can just fly horizon and then like think that maybe once you switch to acro, you're going to have a better idea. If anything, it'll just get you used to being upside down. Something like that. Okay, we've got bound, all the same thing. So pretty much all that is your RX, all right, we know what that means, and your TX right here is going to be bound together. Well, you gotta do it, unless it comes RTF, as another one, we're gonna hit that one later. And what that means is that you have to press a button or something on your receiver sometimes, and then get it ready. And then you do something on your transmitter and get it ready, and it's going to talk to each other, and then they're bound for life. They're married. Yeah. that's a good thing. All right, we got throttle. Throttle means it's going to be this stick right here, or if you're using the other mode, it'll be this one here. Usually it's the loose stick. It doesn't have a spring. And throttle means when you push it up or down, if you have your controls inverted, it will spool the motors up to a higher speed. So throttle on your car would be your gas pedal, and you press it and it makes the motor go faster. Real simple. We got LiPo. That is a battery. Pretty much just a lithium polymer. It uses other like different kinds of metals, magnesium and some other stuff, I guess. It's just a battery. That's a lipo. All right, we got a few different little cells and stuff in there. We're gonna go over that in a second. All right, so we got cells or S's or C or even maybe a P somewhere in the battery names and lingos and stuff like that. So what does that mean? So pretty much at least a lipo, I can vouch for this. A lipo battery is gonna be made up of bricks. Let's just call it bricks, and then the whole battery is the house. So to build a house, we need to build it with bricks. So these bricks can be different sizes and capacities and have higher milliamp hours. We're gonna go over that in a second. And then higher, the more bricks you put together, the higher the voltage, okay? So if you have a 3S battery, you have three cells. Well, cell starts with a C, and you just said S. So why not call it a 3C battery if it has three cells? Well, that's a good question. So the easiest way to answer that is the S means series. Series means in a row, like your favorite television series. So if you have a 3S battery, all three cells are in series, all right? So this is not an electronics lesson. Just know that they're not in parallel. So if you kind of have an idea about that, what that means, good, because I'm not a whole totally 100%. Just know that that's how they work. S means that they're in series. A C on the battery means that is your possible discharge capacity. So how much can the battery discharge all at once and then over an extended period of time? So this is going to be a 70C battery, so it'll discharge 70 somethings. And it's usually a good thing. The higher the number, the better, but not all companies always tell the truth on these. All right, so with this, I've got the information covered up with Velcro, but next we have MAH, milliamp hours. So pretty much that is just the amount of current your battery can discharge in 1 hour. So a lot of math and stuff is involved, but if you just look at your battery, this is a 1300 milliamp. You can have like a 1500 milliamp. You can have a 20,000 milliamp battery. Are you going to put a 20,000 on here and fly all day? No, because the higher the milliamps, the heavier and larger the battery. It's going to be like this big. You can't fly with that. All right, stick to something about this size. You should be good to go. All right, we got CF. What is CF? Do you see that one a whole lot? Maybe, just depends if you're on some forums and somebody's talking about it. Pretty much what CF is, it's super complicated, so I'm going to dumb it down for you. No, it's carbon fiber. So CF is carbon fiber. That's what the frames are made of because it's really freaking strong and really light. So that's that. Is it made of carbon? Probably. And it's fibrous. Makes sense. It's in the name. I don't know. It's got like a little woven texture, and then it's in layers, so it's compressed. It's good stuff. Don't worry about it. You're not going to break it unless you're like crash pretty hard. So you're good to go. All right. We got more abbreviations. We got a FC. What's FC? FC is flight controller. They come in many different shapes and sizes and brands and with different programmings and different orientations and all kind of different fancy stuff. But a flight controller is a flight controller is a flight controller. If it's highly reviewed, and highly used nowadays in the industry, then chances are it's probably a good choice. I can't really recommend anything too crazy. Like I'm running the Pyroflip RC F3 wards right now. They're orange, really cool, real cool looking, and real smooth. They work really well. Pretty much that's just going to be the brain of your quadcopter. It does all the thinking for you. It's got the gyros and the accelerometers, so it knows when it's level, and it tells the ESCs and the motors and all that kind of stuff what to do. So this is the bad boy of the system. Protect your flight controller. It'll protect you. Not from, like, real stuff, just, like, crashing and stuff. But not really, because you're still going to crash if you, yeah. All right, since we're moving on to a few parts on the quad, we have, the next one is ESC. All right, so electronic speed controller. It does just that. It electronically controls the speed of your motors by taking voltages from your power source, power distribution board, and then sending it to the motors, and then controlling how much voltage your motors are going to get to tell them how fast to spin. All right. That being said, the next one is going to be PDB, power distribution board. Some people call them like PCBs, printed circuit boards or something, but I guess pretty much the same thing. It's going to be the bottom layer on most quads down here, and your battery plugs into it, and you got a bunch of stuff. Your ESCs come off of it. You got power coming to your flight controller off of it, probably 5 volts for your flight controller. And that's pretty much that. Nothing too fancy. Some of them come with different options. Your LEDs will be wired to it, all that kind of fun stuff. Alright, so this one I'm going to try and make a decent little analogy for it. If you got your ESCs, the ones that a lot of people are using now, have what's called BL Heli on it, or BL Heli S on it. And pretty much, if you just want to think about that as like if you got a cell phone, the firmware, the programming on your cell phone would be like Android. Let's just call the BL Heli on the ESCs the Android of your programming on your phone. That's not the greatest analogy for that. But then let's call a few other things like one shot or D shot, which is really new right now, or multi shot. What are all the shots? That let's call that like an app on the phone. So that's going to help the ESCs. You can change those. You can change the different shots in Betaflight if you want to change the programming that's on your ESCs to talk to your motors and your flight controller differently and faster and smoother. All right, so we're kind of lagging behind on time here, so I'm gonna speed it up a little bit. We got an OSD, on-screen display. Pretty much all that means is stuff like this and this, all that kind of stuff where it's like you can see voltages and like altitude and like your name or whatever, stuff like that on the screen, okay? What is an RTF, ready to fly? It means like when I got my wizard, it came with the transmitter and the receiver and everything was ready to go. All I had to do was arm it, which I didn't know how to do at the time, and fly, okay? We got a couple of them here. That's gonna be an ARTF, and a BNF. Well, ARTF is gonna be almost ready to fly, and a BNF is gonna be bind and fly. Almost ready to fly can mean a few different things. Pretty much it just means that like maybe you have to put your own receiver in it, maybe you have to assemble it, some things like that. Bind and fly is going to be something like maybe the Tiny Whoop, where it's already got the receiver and everything on it, but you do need to have your own transmitter and you need to bind it, now that we know what that means, to the transmitter to fly. Oh, here's a good one right here. It's going to be ground effect. Sounds really cool. It's not too super cool. But pretty much all that means is that you've got your motor spinning, you got your props on there, and it's pushing air down. If you're too close to the ground, your quad's going to be like skating around on the ground. It's going to be hard to keep it in one spot and level. That just means that the air is pushing down and it's coming back up and it's messing with your quad. Get off the ground a little bit, it'll be a little bit easier to keep that thing level and you're not messing with the ground effect, okay? This one here's a little confusing for some, even though they may know what it means, but they don't know what they want out of it. So FOV, field of view. Wider field of view is going to be wider in your eyes. Field of view means like how far you can view, how you know, in the size and your peripheral vision and stuff, and the goggles. So a more narrow field of view is going to be like you're looking at a television screen. A more wide field of view is going to be like it's like in your face. That is all totally up to preference. Some people like wide, some people don't. If you can, find some people around you and try out different versions, because you don't want to spend $300 on something and not like it, you know? Ah, here's a good one. This one actually confused the heck out of me when I first saw it. We got AUW, all up weight. What does that mean? Well, real simple, real fast, it is all the weight on the quad that it's gonna have when you take off. So if you put something online, you're like, man, my quad's only 300 grams. And then somebody says, yeah, but what's the AUW? What's the all-up weight? How much does it weigh with the battery? And a GoPro. Yeah, you gotta think the GoPros are heavy or whatever. How much is all the weight when it's ready to fly in the air? Ah, here's a good one. I'm gonna read off the list for this one. The FAA. If you live in the United States of America, then you may know who this is. You may have heard it before. It is the Federal Aviation Administration, United States Department of Transportation Agency, and it has authority to regulate and oversee all aspects of American civil aviation. Yeah, so just do what they say. I mean, if they want you to register your stuff or yourself, do it. Don't fly over 400 feet if that's what they want, then just don't. Just play by the rules so we don't get the whip cracked on us, all right? Let's see, what else we have here? Ah, We got some Fs. What's the Fs? We got a BF, a CF, and then like an RF, okay? What is that? Well, you got a beta flight, clean flight, race flight, and then all these things are just, like I said earlier with the ESCs, you have like your programming or your firmware that's on them. Well, your flight controllers are going to have the programming on them as well. If you look at the chip that came with the Wizard, a lot of times it's going to say it's got clean flight on it right there. Well, it didn't come with clean flight on most, pretty much all of them. It came with beta flight. So you can what's called flash, I'll get that, the programming onto the chips, and the programming is on the computer, and pretty much it crunches the numbers for you. It's doing all the math on the chip, and it's talking to the gyros and everything for you, and different people prefer different programs, but they all are pretty similar. So flash. What does flash mean? It's like fast, super fast. No, it doesn't mean that. It means, I don't know why they call it flash. I didn't really bother even looking. It's so dumb. So pretty much flash just means like you're putting the programming onto something. So if you want to flash your ESCs or you want to flash your flight controller, and it even says it in Betaflight down at the bottom, it says flash firmware. You pretty much just put the firmware on it. That's what they mean. Like, I don't know why they call it flash. The Notorious P.I.D.s. that's a good rap name, Notorious P.I.D. We got proportional integral derivative. Yeah. Pretty much that's just three parameters. What's a parameter? Well, just three numbers, let's call it that, that you can change on your flight controller in the programming, and it changes how the quad flies. It changes how it reacts to the inputs of the sticks. But not in a sense where, like, if you increase the number, it's going to make it go faster. Just in a sense to where if you move the stick like this, it's the flight controller is not going to want to go and shake when you're doing certain movements. Whew. All right. I did not expect to get that all done in one sitting, but I'm really glad I did, because now I get to finish maybe hopefully editing this and getting it out for you guys, and then starting on the next video, because I got some stuff backed up right now. I need to work on that. But I wanted to say I really appreciate you guys watching the videos and subscribing and commenting on all my stuff and going over to the FPV NoobTube and being part of the community. That has just been like the best thing ever. I never really expected I never could have expected this outcome from just a couple videos that I uploaded onto YouTube. And it wasn't something that I really was looking for. I'm not trying to profit off of this channel at all. All I'm trying to do is create a community of beginners and just an open, inviting community for people in the FPV hobby in general to come and all together and just share their experiences and their knowledge and just have a great time, you know? Just a really inviting area for all. It's funny, I've actually got I do have a Patreon set up now, only because I posted on the FPV NoobTube Facebook group that we're looking to get a website set up, and that it's going to cost a lot more money than what we thought. And everybody was like, "Dude, set up a Patreon." I said, "No, man, I don't want to ask you guys for money. You know, I got a little bit of revenue on my YouTube channel, but it's not something that like I haven't even cashed out yet, because I don't even make enough." And if I did, then all of that would go towards the FPV NoobTube anyway, because that's your money, guys. That's not mine. I got a job. I'm a firefighter, and I love my job. I love helping people. So that's why I do what I do, and that's why I started the FPV NoobTube, so I help all you guys out. So if you want to, you can go over to the Patreon, and you can contribute that way. But, you know, if not, I'd really much rather you just go over to the FPV NoobTube Facebook group, and then once we get the website set up, go contribute that away, and go contribute to the community in a way that everybody can appreciate, where, you know, just share some knowledge and some experiences and just some cool videos of you flying and just have a great time. With that being said, guys, I'm going to end this video. Like I said, I really want to thank everybody that is contributing via Patreon, because I'm just beyond words right now that strangers would give money it's crazy. Like, I'm beyond words right now. Like, they're giving money to us It's just not me. I'm not taking this money. I'm not buying quad parts and all this stuff with it. It all goes back to you guys. I want to do some amazing giveaways for you guys, and I want to be able to sustain the website and a bunch of other fun stuff in the future. That's a secret right now. Anyways, guys, little secret at the end of this video. If you made it all the way here, then you are like the super OG noob. I am doing a giveaway at 1,000 subscribers, and I'm super excited about that. You can't know what it is yet because it's a super secret, and nobody knows except for you. She knows. She has her headphones in, though, so she can't hear me. But with that said, guys, as usual, be safe, but fly it like you stole it.